Time to look at another anti-tank gun of the Panzermuseum Munster who invited me in 2020. This time we look at the famous, or rather infamous, 37mm Puck 36, which served as the standard anti-tank gun for the Germans at the beginning of the war. First, the origin. It goes back to February 1925, when the development for the anti-tank gun was ordered that should have a weight of less than 250kg and at 600 meter be able to penetrate 40mm of armor plate at a 30 degree angle. The first two prototypes were ready in 1928. Note that initially it was called 3.7 cm Tank Abwehrkanone. I will discuss the naming a bit later in this video. Parallel to this was the development of the telescopic sight, the 3.0 cm armor piercing shell with tracer and base use, as well as a brass cartridge case. The first production models were produced in 1929, and in 1932 a total of 262 had been produced. Yet, due to secrecy, no troop trials were conducted. At this point, the gun had spoked wooden wheels, not rubber tires, as you can see here. Generally, from what I know about German equipment, spoked wheels were used for equipment that was towed by horse, whereas rubber tires were used for equipment towed by motor vehicles. According to Fleischer, in 1934, the anti-tank arm was reorganized. As such, the guns were converted to rubber tires with suspension. Guderian notes in his book Achtung Panzer, the Inspectorate of Motorized Troops had already for some time been conducting driving and firing tests with an air-tired 3.7 cm gun, which were fully satisfactory. Now the task arose of setting up a fast-moving, so motorized anti-tank battalions for the higher command. All the major units of the army were equipped with these battalions, and their method of fighting was developed in cooperation with the tanks, and thus the defensive power of the army against the dangerous tank enemy was increased. To put it simply, since a tank is rather fast, to properly fight tanks you need to make sure that your anti-tank weapons are ideally faster, so you can relocate them in time to engage the tanks. This is the reason why the German anti-tank units were generally motorized even in regular infantry divisions, although due to losses and shortages during the war, towing by horse was used again. As mentioned, originally it was called 3.0 cm Tank Abwehrkanone, yet in 1936 it was renamed Panzerabwehrkanone 36. The short name for this is Puck 36. Yet in April 1940 the anti-tank arm was renamed into Panzerjäger, literally Tank Hunter. As such, the gun was now called 3.0 cm Panzerjägerkanone. Although the short name for this and other anti-tank guns was still Puck, so generally both Panzerjägerkanone and Panzerabwehrkanone are correct. But for the short name, only Puck is correct. This caused some confusion in my video on the Puck 40, sorry for not clearing that up. Now, the initial name was Tankabwehrkanone, not Panzerabwehrkanone. The reason for this is that the Germans for quite some time used tank as well. Now, the word Panzer is also the word for armor, and in various forms Panzer was already used for armored vehicles in the First World War. For instance, Anleitung für die Verwendung von Sturmpanzerkraftwagenabteilungen, Manual for the Employment of Assault Armored Vehicle Battalions from January 1918. Yet the tank was still a rather new vehicle and the nomenclature was still dynamic. As Heigl in his Taschenbuch der Tanks, Paperback of Tanks, from 1935 notes about the word Kampfwagen, literally combat car, which basically meant a tank. Abroad and popularly they are also often referred to as tanks, elsewhere as armored assault vehicles. Ultimately, the Kampfwagen turned into Panzerkampfwagen and that turned into Panzer. Yet the word tank was still used at least once even during the Second World War, namely in a German pamphlet from January 1942. About Sorbert mines and explosive devices, the anti-tank dogs are called Tankhunde, literally tank dogs. Of course, this was likely not an expert of the armor branch. Anyway, let us take a short look at the gun. As you can see, unlike the 50mm Puck 38 and the 75mm Puck 40, this gun has no muscle brake, since the recoil was rather limited. Muscle brakes reduce the recoil but have certain drawbacks like increased production cost, and more importantly, they can throw up dust and debris, which not only limits the visibility of the crew, but also give away the position of the gun to the enemy. Note the recoil absorber below the barrel. It notes, Glycerini, which is Finnish for glycerol, and was used as an anti-freezing agent. We are now being behind the gun shield. As you can see at the top, there is written Peruskorjattu, which is Finnish for renovated. The date seems to be the 15th February 1944. So assuming the markings are correct, this gun was used by the Finnish in the later stages of the war. If you look at the small opening in the armored shield, you see a short slot. This is where the scope would be attached. Note that the slot can be closed. The two wheels on the left are for elevation and side traverse. The lower one is for the side traverse, whereas the upper one is for the elevation. It also has the firing button on it. The little box on the back of the gun shield contains a cleaning kit. Here at the back you can see the tray spades. Those would be spread out and they would dig into the ground, so that the remaining recoil is absorbed by the earth and not the gunner's face. And no, this is not a joke. One regulation states that depending on the conditions for the first shots, the gunner has to keep a distance of 30 to 35 cm, about 1 foot, to the scope. Yet the best part is probably this. If there is no time to dig out the position for the trail spades, or if it is not possible because of the firm ground, Rifleman 3, the armor bearer, and Rifleman 4, also armor bearer, will lie with their upper bodies on the spars to absorb the recoil. By the way, for a closer look at the gun with an attached sight and explanation for firing and loading mechanism, check out Forgotten Weapons video. Let us look at the crew, their roles and position. Note, the following information is from an army regulation from 1938 from the cavalry branch. The regulation does not specify which anti-tank gun was used, yet since the organization for a 1937 anti-tank company of the infantry has the same organization, this was likely the standard setup at the time. The crew consists of only 5 men, one squad leader or gun leader, a gunner, a loader, and 2 armor bearers. If you watched my video on the Pak 40, you will immediately notice quite a difference here. First, the crew is far smaller with just 5 instead of 8 men, which isn't particularly surprising considering the size difference. Yet more interesting is that this time there is no driver indicated in the regulation as part of the gun crew. This is likely related to the fact that there are 2 types of organization listed in the manual. The regulations outlines 2 options, one with 1 vehicle, which also means 1 driver, and one with 2 vehicles, with 2 drivers. So the crew size is actually 6 or 7, not just 5 men. Another interesting difference to the Pak 40 organization is that there was no crew member equipped with a machine gun. Yet the gun platoon consists of 3 anti-tank guns had a light machine gun section with 1 MG34. According to regulation, the role of this section was defense against air and soft targets. Next we look at the different crew positions in the firing position. The gun leader would be positioned to the left of the gun. Of course, depending on the situation, he would change his position. If necessary, still later it is noted that the gun leader should be positioned close to the gunner. The gunner was on the left side of the breech. He controlled the traverse and elevation. The loader was on the right side. The regulation states that he must be aware of the traverse of the gun, so he does not get injured. The first armor bearer was behind him and would hand him the next cartridge, holding it on the upper part, whereas the loader would take it on the lower part. The second armor bearer was further behind. His job was to provide ammunition for the other armor bearer and report the armor situation. Let's move on. About crew training, the following is mentioned. All crews assigned to the gun are to be trained in the activities of all crew members, so that they can support and replace each other in all situations. Rapid combat readiness and rapid firing require smooth cooperation among all riflemen. This is to be considered from the beginning of the training. Now it is time to address the elephant in the room. This gun has a rather infamous reputation for being a weak anti-tank gun. Many people know that it was called the Heeresanklopfgerät, the army door knocker device, due to its rather poor penetration capabilities. This is generally correct, but requires some context. As already mentioned, this gun was developed in the 1920s. It was introduced in the 1930s. Fleischer notes that for the mid-1930s, the penetration values were already not adequate anymore. The question is how much of this is hindsight, since we should not forget that the Germans built the Panzer II with the 20mm autocannon for anti-tank purposes, outlined in my video about it. And even in September 1939, they had no high explosive ammo for the tank. Of course, in France and especially the Soviet Union in 1941, this gun was not a threat for heavy tanks or even well-armored medium tanks at all. But this was the case for nearly all German guns in service at that time. So it was more a problem with the capabilities of German anti-tank weaponry at the time than with the gun in particular, which becomes even more apparent considering that the successor, the 50mm Puck 38, was of limited effectiveness in 1941 already. So one could say that the Puck 36 was more of a symptom than the actual problem. Yet let us look at the summaries of troop reports from the Battle of France. In questionnaires after the battle, all of 26 formations listed that the 37mm Puck was ineffective, nicht bewährt, literally not proven, for anti-tank duties. Yet when it came to other duties, like firing at embrasures, two formations noted it was especially effective, and 30 noted it was effective, while no formation reported it as ineffective. Additionally, and this is particularly surprising, when used with high explosive rounds, a total of 24 formations noted it was especially effective, and 13 it was effective. Furthermore, 23 formations noted that the gun was especially feared by the enemy in this respect. This is quite surprising considering that this is a rather small round, yet due to the rather small size, this gun has a high rate of fire. Fleischer notes about 10 to 15 shots per minute. This in combination with its low combat weight of 450 kg and thus good tactical mobility was apparently very useful for close support. To put the weight in contrast, the 50mm Puck 38 already had a weight of 950 kg and the 75mm Puck 40 weighed more than 3 times as much with 1425 kg. Yet back to the main job of the gun, engaging tanks, there were attempts to improve the penetration capabilities of the Puck 36. One was the use of the sub-caliber ammunition with a tungsten core. This was introduced in 1940, yet these rounds had a shorter range. At 100 meter, which is very close, the penetration was 64 mm against the 30 degree angled armored plate, versus 35 mm of the regular AP round. But already at 400 meter, this value dropped to 37 mm, whereas the regular shot had 29 mm at 500 meter. Later, there was another attempt to keep the gun in use against tanks by using an overcaliber hollow charge projectile. Hollow charge or shaped charges, also known as heat for high explosive anti-tank, have the benefit that the penetration values are independent of the velocity of the projectile. One drawback is that hollow charge warheads have a minimum caliber to be effective. And at least back then, 37mm did not cut it. This upgrade was the 3.0cm Stielgranate 41, which was introduced in early 1942. Inside, this perforated tail was a solid rod that slipped into the muzzle of the gun, allowing the tail unit to pass over the outer surface of the barrel. A separate loading cartridge was used to fire the bomb. The main issue of this projectile was the slow velocity, low effective range, low rate of fire, and the loader had to expose himself. Although the penetration value of 180 mm was excellent and even adequate for 1945. Despite the low effective range of 300 meters, in early 1942 the troops requested more of this projectile, according to Dr. Roman Töppel, referring to the war diary of the Army Group North, since it was the only way besides the 88mm flak to deal with heavy Soviet tanks. Let us take a look at the regulations a bit. These include some general principles on the employment of the gun. The individual gun is the firing unit. As a rule, it solves the combat missions in the platoon. Loss of the platoon leader and adjacent guns, failure of communication with the platoon leader, and the rapidly changing course of battle often require independent action by the individual gun. The next point is about the firing position. When scouting and setting up the firing position, consider good field of fire at effective firing distances, horizontal stance of wheels for all directions, dustproof ground in front of the muzzle. If necessary, the field of fire must be cleared. The gun should be able to fire in all directions. Position the gun for combat, if possible, so that it can fire just over cover. Here check with a short look through the barrel, not through the telescopic sight, with a cover can be overshot. Reconnaissance is sufficient if the gun succeeds in reaching unseen a firing position from which it can accomplish its mission. Well, I guess the Germans already had sentient autonomous guns back then. In the section about the firefight, I found the following part particularly interesting. After the gun is positioned, The gang leader is close to the ganger in order to have the same field of view as far as possible, and thus to facilitate target designation and fire control. The firearms should not be put away. Riflemen 3 and 4 carry the rifle on their backs in the firing position. Note, the other members were equipped with a pistol. I assume this instruction is done that nobody forgets his rifle in case the gun needs to reposition in the heat of battle. One aspect that I'm not sure I fully understand in the regulation is the following part. Alternate position and changing positions are covered, yet this part also includes a rather strict, emphasized line. The change of position to the alternate position is carried out before the firefight only if it is recognized ahead of time, otherwise after the firefight. For short distances, the change of position is performed with the crew moving the gun. The gun leader hurries ahead to guide the gun into the alternate position along the scouted path. Evasion of enemy fire during a tank attack is prohibited. About the last line, I assume this is due to the fact that the anti-tank guns were at that time the only dedicated weapon system that could engage tanks, and since it was known that tanks had a strong effect on morale, any change in position by the anti-tank guns could be perceived as a retreat by the other arms, and thus might break the morale of surrounding units and or incite them to retreat or even rout. Since I was not sure about this, I asked also Dr. Roman Töppel, who noted that might be a likely interpretation. Additionally, he noted the reasoning could also be that the anti-tank gun was particularly vulnerable while moving, and as such the risk of losing the gun and or the crew was particularly high. If you know why, please let us know in the comment section. Finally, let us look at the production. For before the war, I did not find production numbers, but numbers on the existing guns in German service. In August 1938, according to Fleischer, 8,449 were in service. So likely a bit more were produced. In September 1939, Hahn notes that 11,200 were in service. Wartime production was generally low. In 1939, 1,229 were produced, in 1940, 2,730, in 1941, 1,365, and finally for 1942, a mere 32. Yet the production of replacement barrels was continued, and assuming that the writing on the gun of the Panzermuseum Munster is correct, this gun was likely still used in 1944. You need, of course, to keep in mind here that you can use this gun also with high explosive ammunition. But the armor-piercing shell is also useful against soft-skinned vehicles, because without an engine block, your advance might be limited. Similarly, there are plenty of lightly armored vehicles out there as well, like self-propelled guns, half-tracks, and armored cars. Remember, not everyone drives around in a Sherman or even T-34, even in 1944 or 45, especially in more backwater areas of the front. Well, I hope you learned something new. Big thank you to the Panzermuseum Munster for inviting me in 2020. Thank you to Dr. Roman Töppel for information about the Stielgranate 41 and discussion on the instructions in the regulation. Thank you to Andrew for reviewing the script and providing additional input. Yet any errors are my own. Thank you to all my supporters on Patreon and Subscribestar for making videos like this possible. Sources are listed in the description. Thank you for watching and see you next time.